Hello everyone, welcome back to the session. So in this session, we are going to learn about the Git lifecycle and how it works. So without wasting any time, let's go ahead and understand the Git lifecycle. So guys, in Git lifecycle or about any file who exists or which exists in Git, it goes through the following stages, right? The file first exists in the working directory, okay? Once it exists in the working directory, once we finalize the file, we start to stage the file for production, or we start to stage the file for committing. So we stage the file using git add command, and it gets staged in the staging area. Once it gets staged in the staging area, the next step would be to completely save the file inside the Git version system by committing it, right? So the next stage, or the third stage, or the last stage is committing the file to the Git file system. Okay, so these are the three lifecycle stages of a Git file in the Git file system. Now let's understand each of these three stages separately. So the first stage is working directory. Now what is a working directory? Any folder in which your code resides can be termed as a working directory. The working directory could or could not be tracked by Git. It is not necessary that, you know, Git should be tracking or Git should be versioning your files inside the folder. Only then it will be called your working directory. Any directory that you're working in which has your code in it will be called your working directory. Now, you choose which files have to be saved in the Git file system. For example, not all files will be saved. For example, in your working directory, you would have some output files, you would have, you would have some input files probably also. You only want the main code to be saved in Git, right? The input and the output files are arbitrary files, which could also be generated while your program is being executed, right? So you don't want your input files or your output files to be there in your Git file system. That's why you have an option to stage files. Now, what is the staging area? In staging area, you basically choose which files, you want to commit. So basically imagine it like this, that, you know, you have your working directory and then you have a stage for Git. On the stage, you put the files that you want to commit. So in the working directory, you choose the files that you want to be tracked by Git. And once you choose those files automatically become staged. And hence the term staging area. So the files in the staging area are the files which are to be committed. Okay. Moving further, then we have commit. So once we have came down to a list which we want to commit and they are ready in the staging area, all we have to do is pass the command git commit, and all our files will now have a new commit ID attached to them, and they will now be saved in the Git file system. Okay, so that is what commit is all about. So if the files are selected and are ready in the staging area, they can now be saved in the repository. Saving a file in the repository of Git is known as commit, right? When we commit a repository in Git, the commit is identified by a commit ID. We already discussed this. And the command for initializing this process is called git commit. So let us not get into the commands. We'll talk about the commands as we move along when we go to the commands section of Git. Okay, so these were the three lifecycle stages of Git. Moving forward, guys, now let's understand the lifecycle of Git using a diagram. Like we discussed what working directory is, staging area is, and what commit is. Now let us see it in action. Okay, so this is your programming workspace, guys, and this is basically your working directory. Okay, now the first step to basically start saving your files or putting your files in Git is to first initialize a Git repository. So inside this program workspace, what you do is you type the command git init. Now what it does, it basically starts tracking your files. So now Git has initialized in your repository. It creates a hidden .git file, which will basically have information of all the files which are there in folder right now, right? So we have a Git initialized working directory now. And inside this initialized working directory, you have your files. But mind you guys, these files are not yet saved in the Git file system. They're just existing in a Git initialized file, right? Now the next step is to basically stage the files that you want to commit. Right, so you choose the files that you want to commit and you type the command git add followed by the files that you want to commit, and these files now get into the staging area. Now the staging area is where you can see all the files that are ready to be committed, right? Once you have staged the files, the next step would be to committing the files to your Git repository. The moment you commit your file to a Git repository, it gets attached itself to a commit ID, and now your file is successfully saved inside the Git repository. But mind you guys, everything which happened from here till here is happening inside your local system, right? Everything is happening on the local. But Git is all about collaborative effort. It's all about teamwork. It's all about you contributing to a project on which hundreds or 200s or millions of people are working, right? So now how do you get your file or how do you get your project which you have modified or created onto the internet or onto the or among the people who would be ready to contribute to it? Now, the next thing is we need an entity where we could put our files, right? We need an entity where everyone can access it. So this entity is called GitHub. Right. So after committing your files, the next step what you can do is you can push your files to a remote repository. Right. And what pushing basically means is whatever is there on your local repository, all the version history, everything gets pushed or gets uploaded to a remote repository which exists on GitHub. So it could be GitHub, it could be Bitbucket, there could be any platform which could host your code. But we're choosing GitHub because it's a free and popular tool that probably each and everyone who is a developer or a tester would have used in his lifetime, right? Also, almost every open source project is also actually hosted on GitHub. So that is also an awesome thing. Okay, so this diagram basically depicts the whole life cycle of Git, where you start from a program workspace where you have your code, then you initialize it, the folder to become a Git initialized working directory. Then once you have done with your code, what you do is you stage the files which you want to commit to the Git repository, which is called the staging area. And then you move ahead and commit the files to the Git file system, basically the files which were there in the staging area. And once you feel that, you know, your repository is ready to be seen by the world, what you do is you push your files onto a remote repository such as GitHub, where all your teams can collaborate and add their code as well. Okay, so this is exactly how Git functions and how the Git lifecycle is. Our next topic is how Git actually works. Okay, so now for understanding, so we've understood the lifecycle of Git. We know how, you know, how a file goes through the process of a file from the part where it exists in a folder to a part it exists in a remote repository. We know the process now. But let us now understand what happens in the backend. Right, how is Git functioning internally? Let us discuss that. Now, any file that you save or store on Git is actually stored using commit. Right, we have already discussed this, and each commit is assigned a commit ID. Right, so every commit that you do on Git is assigned a unique commit ID to it, through which it can basically save itself, or it can go ahead and identify. Okay, so these six files in the state that they are saved as it is in this commit ID. Tomorrow, if I change the CSV file, say I add one line or I add two lines, and then I again save it on GitHub, it will be saved inside another commit ID, right? But whatever you save in Git, whenever you have committed something on Git, it gets saved forever. You cannot edit that now, right? So it gets frozen inside the commit ID. Okay, so the first thing that you do on Git is you commit your folder, and now the folder becomes or your repository becomes a part of Git using a commit ID. Now, if you want to tomorrow to add a new file to your project, say I add this file, a CSS file to my project, I add that and I add some code to it. Now, when I will save my repository, it will have 7 files instead of 6, and it'll be saved inside another commit ID. Okay, now why are commit IDs important? Now, for example, when I uploaded this code stopped working. So all I want to do now is I want to revert back to the previous commit, and all I have to type in is git revert and this commit ID, and my code will be up and running again, because my earlier code was running but this code had some fault in it. So rather than identifying where the fault is exactly, meanwhile what I do is I do a git revert so that my previous application is up and running, and now I can basically just do a bisection, or I can basically introspect what exactly went wrong in my code. And once I've figured out what went wrong in my code, I can fix it, again commit it, and then my code will become live. Okay, so again, so these are the things you can, this is how basically your files are stored inside Git. Now, all these commits basically, they exist on a branch. Okay, now what is a branch? A branch is nothing but a linear line which is unidirectional. That is, all the commits which are added will be added in front of the last commit. So the starting of the branch would be commit, the first commit that you do. The second commit would come after that. The third commit would come after that. The fourth after that. You can never add a commit on the previous position of the branch. Okay, it always moves forward. And a branch also has a component called head. the head of the branch always points to the latest commit. Okay, so if I have a commit ID which is 0001, and if this is the only commit which is there on the branch, the head will also point over here, right? The moment I add one more commit to the branch, the head will start pointing over there, right? Now, if I want to refer to this commit ID, all I have to do is I can refer it to either by head or I can refer it to by this commit ID. Okay, so this is what a branch is. Now, this branch is called the master branch. Okay, so your project can have multiple branches, but by default, there is only one branch whenever you initialize a Git repository, and that one branch is called the master branch. So any files that you saved, any commits that you made are all saved on the master branch until unless you have one more branch that you're working on, but that you have to do manually. If you're not creating any branch, you're just simply working on Git, everything is being saved on the master branch. Now, but why do we need branches? We have discussed what branches are. You understood, okay, so it's a linear line which is unidirectional, which always moves forward. But the point is, why do we need a branch? Why can't we just have commits, right? So we need a branch because we use commit or we use Git basically for team collaboration. Now, for example, you want to enhance this code. Whatever code was there in commit ID 002, you added a CSS. You want to further enhance it and say, probably I want a login page to also be added to this website. Now, what you do is you basically assign this code to a developer, right? And how do you assign it? You create a new branch for this feature. So this branch would be called feature A branch. This branch can also be called the login page branch. It's up to you what you want to name it, right? So you name this branch something, and now what happens is the developer gets a new branch where a commit has now been made, which basically corresponds to the commit which was there on my master branch. And now what I can do is this developer can do is he can work on this code, add his feature, and again commit to it. Now, when this developer will commit back to GitHub, or when he will commit back to Git, his code will be added on the feature A branch. Okay, it will not be added on the master branch. Why is it done so? It is done because my master branch should always contain code which is ready, which is polished, which is ready for production. It should not have any incomplete code. It should not have any untested code, right? So that's why we isolate the development of the code from the master branch by creating a new branch with the name of what that branch actually does, right? Now, this developer or several developers can work on this branch, add as many commits as they want till they get the perfect finished code. And when they feel the code, is finished, is done, what they do is they finally commit to this branch that this is the code that we feel is perfect. And after that, the testing is also done, everything is done. And if everything goes well, what happens is you can merge this branch back to the master branch. Okay, the moment you merge this branch back to the master branch, the commit gets added onto the master branch as a new commit, and now your master branch again has completed code, right? So this is how basically Git works, and this is how team collaboration happens on GitHub, right? Now, so we discussed theoretically how basically Git works and how different operations or different things can happen on Git. But now we haven't seen in real practice, right? We don't know if I have to create a branch, how can I actually create it in Git? If I have to save a file on the Git file system, if I have to initialize a repository, how can I actually do that, right? So in our next session, we're going to talk about some of the prominent common Git commands that you will be using in your day-to-day life for doing some operations on Git, right? So in our next session, we're going to talk about the common Git commands. So see you in the next session. Have a great day ahead and goodbye.